Good morning to all. At the outset, I extend my warm welcome to today's chief guest, Shri Shailesh Gandhi sir. Sir, on behalf of entire family of Marathwada Mitramanda, I am very thankful to you to grace the occasion. I also welcome the team of Moneylife Foundation who are actively involved and who are instrumental in organizing this program. We are very fortunate that on very first day for inauguration session, we got an opportunity to organize this, what we can say, vibrant program, because information is nowadays very important, and we, being common people, don't know how to use it, what is the importance of it. So today we are going to get this space through Shailesh Gandhi sir, and we will get sensitized. Sir, every year, as Revati Naik ma'am mentioned, that we all are from law faculty, and today the entire world is facing problem related to human rights issues. So if we start from us, then only we are able to tell others. So to sensitize students, to inculcate these values related to human rights amongst the students, we are organizing this Human Rights Week. We are conducting many activities for this sensitization during the entire week, and today is the inauguration session, and from today we will start celebrating this week. This is not actually celebration, this is a, what we can say, we are thinking and giving deep thoughts over human rights issues, and students are mainly involved into this. Briefly, I will give introduction of our institution also, of our law college also. Law College is established in 2003, and recently we have completed 16 years in imparting quality legal education. Around 1300 students are presently they are studying in the institute. Last year college went for NAC accreditation, and in very first cycle the college is accredited with A grade by NAC Bangalore. So many passed out students of this college, they are working as a lawyer in corporate, and many students are working in the capacity of judge also. Recently, just 5 months before, one JMFC examination was conducted, and in that examination 7 students from our college, they have qualified, and now they will be entering into the judicial profession. So we know that we are miles to go away, but we are trying to celebrate each and every mile whenever we get an opportunity. So with this note, once again I welcome you all, and without taking much time, we can start the session. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Friends, today we are very fortunate to have amongst us Shailesh Gandhi sir. Sir, we really feel privileged to have you here as a chief guest and resource person of one day workshop on the right to information. I now request Principal Dr. Kranti Deshmukh madam to felicitate Shailesh Gandhi sir. Thank you. Right to Information Act has become a pioneer tool to the citizens of India for promoting, protecting and defending their right to know. Transparency and accountability in the administration is the sine qua non of participatory democracy. Information is the oxygen that any citizen needs to live in the social structure of society and maintain its democratic balance. Today, we are very fortunate to have Shailesh Gandhi sir to guide us on right to information, which plays an instrumental role in the effective exercise of wide range of human rights. Sir is the former Central Information Commissioner of India. He is associated with Moneylife Foundation, which is one of the fastest growing non-governmental organization in India and one of the foremost organization which deals in various public policy issues, research, RTI, consumer awareness and advocacy. As a RTI activist, sir has not merely used the RTI but also trained many citizens and government officials in over 1000 workshops to use it. He has disposed many cases pertaining to RTI. Sir was convener of National Campaign for People's Right to Information. For his work, he has been awarded the Nani Palkhiwala Civil Liberties Award and Mr. Pai Award. He has also published a book titled RTI Act, Authentic Interpretation of the Statute. We are very honored to have you here, sir. I now request sir to address the gathering.
Fellow citizens of India, I am an old man, and when I was driving from Mumbai to Pune today, a thought came to me, which is the world's largest democracy?
India.
Sure.
Yes.
You are convinced?
Yes.
When I was in school, I was taught that democracy is rule of the people, for the people, by the people. Is that definition correct or has it changed?
Yes.
Correct. Okay. If you go to a government office, do you think you will be treated like a ruler of this country? You? Do you think you would be treated as a ruler of this country? Then how are we a democracy? You agreed that India is the world's largest democracy. You agreed that democracy means rule of the people, for the people, by the people. And you are all saying that nobody will treat us as a ruler. Then are we a democracy? Yes or no?
Yes.
Why are we a democracy if we are not, if you don't feel your rule exists, how is it a democracy? We call India the world's largest democracy because we have a reasonably fair system of elections by which we are able to change leaders, change governments. I would submit to you that having a constitution and a fair system of elections are necessary conditions of democracy, but are not the complete set of conditions. The heart and essence of democracy is the concept that each individual citizen is a sovereign in her own right, and she gives up part of the sovereignty to the state, in return for which she gets the rule of law. Sovereignty of the individual is the key and heart of democracy, is the key and heart of human rights, in fact. Human rights have no meaning if an individual human being is not respected. That is the fundamental basis of human rights. And in Hindi, we use the word Lokshahi. In the Marathi also, we use the word Lokshahi. Lokshahi means logon ki shahanshahi. You, friend, if you go to a government office, should feel like a badshah. You, ma'am, if you go to a government office, should feel like a begum. But that doesn't happen, does it? One place I was talking about democracy and this aspect, and a young student like you got up and said, Mr. Gandhi, ye baatein to achhi chikni chupdi lagti hai. Sab badshah aur begum ban gaye. 130 crore badshah aur begum se desh chal sakta hai kya? Aapko kya lagta hai? No. Okay. Let me share with you, it does happen. And I'd like to give you two instances of this in the Western democracies, which are more advanced. The first example I'd give you of is the United States of America. I'm not saying everything in USA is good, but in terms of democracy, they have a 2-century lead over us. An immigrant from India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, China, who has applied for a green card or citizenship of United States, will very easily pick up the telephone and ask about the status of his application. Whether his application is okay, whether there are any defects, when is it likely to be considered, so on and so forth. And 99%, he will get a perfectly rational answer from the other side of the telephone. You are all first-rate citizens of India. If you have applied for change of address in your ration card, and you don't get a response, will you pick up the phone to ask?
No.
Why? You don't have a phone? You have a phone, but you are so confident that if you call up, either nobody will pick up the phone, and if somebody picks up the phone, they will not give you any sensible response. They will say, tum kya collector ho, minister ho kya? Even if you go to that office, your chances of getting a proper answer are 50%. Respect for the individual is lacking. That is what I am trying to point out to you. The same example I'd like to give you is a story that you've all heard, but look at it from a slightly different perspective that I'm going to share with you. Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi got inside that train in South Africa 125 years back. He had a first class ticket, but the white man objected and hence he was taken off the train. In that same story is written that Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi filed a complaint by telegram complaining about what had happened to him. And in 12 to 14 hours, a railway official came and put him on the next train. Think of the significance of this story. Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi was not a citizen of South Africa. By South African law, he was a second-rate human being. Even as a human being, the South African law treated him as a second-rate human being because he was not a white man. Yet, he complains. No mobile phones, no internet. And yet the system responds in 12 to 14 hours because a human being has complained. Today's Indian Railway, if you file a complaint, forget 12 to 14 hours, in 12 to 14 days, if you get an acknowledgement, you will feel you are blessed. Respect for the individual. Jo parat एक माणूसला रिस्पेक्ट भेटत नाही तोपर्यंत लोकशाही नाही डेमोक्रेसी नाही ह्युमन राईट्सचा सर्व गोष्ट युजलेस आहे. ह्युमन राईट्स इज नॉट अबाउट जस्ट स्टॉपिंग अट्रॉसिटीज. ह्युमन राईट्स इज नॉट अबाउट स्टॉपिंग समबडी फ्रॉम असॉल्टिंग समबडी. ह्युमन राईट्स इज डीपर. रिस्पेक्ट फॉर द इंडिव्हिज्युअल, रिस्पेक्ट फॉर अ ह्युमन बीइंग इज द सेंट्रल पॉइंट ऑफ ऑल ह्युमन राईट्स. बिकॉज यू आर अ ह्युमन बीइंग यू डिझर्व रिस्पेक्ट. One human being must respect another human being because that person is a human being. And if they zala tar, everything else follows. It is not the other way around. Whereas we look at everything else. Crop atrocities, kudala kai zala tar tyala bachwa. That is not human rights. I mean, that is part of human rights. But the fundamental we are missing, without a foundation, you cannot build a construction. You cannot construct a building. And that is what right to information does for the first time in our nation. If a major catastrophe hits Pune and 100,000 people collect, nothing will happen to a public servant. At best, he'll get transferred. Here is a law which says that if one individual asks for information and that is denied to him or her, the public official is liable to a penalty personally payable up to 25,000 rupees. This establishes the sovereignty of the individual citizen. Respect of the individual citizen is restored by this law. And this is the first law in this country that does something like this. And that is why we believe it's a great citizen empowerment tool which is likely to change the face of India and change the face of democracy in India. I will talk to you about some of the provisions of the law. This is a very simple law. This is one of the best acts in the world. And I'm not a lawyer, incidentally. I'm an engineer by training. If I can understand it, all of you are brighter, younger, and smarter than me. And trained in law. I'm sure you will understand it much better. Understand the law. And here's a proposition I want to put before you. Law is what is written and passed by parliament or state legislature. Law is not what the President of India says or the Prime Minister of India or the Supreme Court Chief Justice. And legal certainty is a universal concept of law. Laws have to be made certain. Decisions have to be made such that law is understood by anybody. Otherwise, how will a citizen, how will any government officer follow the law? If there is no legal certainty, you cannot follow the law. Therefore, talking of a rule of law in the absence of legal certainty is a misnomer, is an oxymoron. Having said this, let's launch into trying to understand the Right to Information Act. Let me give you a brief history of this. The first such law of transparency was passed in Sweden on 2nd December 1776, 250 years back. After that, for nearly 150 years, no other country passed such laws. In the last century, about 120 countries have passed this, such a law, and they are known by three different names: Freedom of Information, FOI, Access to Information, API, Right to Information, RTI. When did the first such movement start in India? 1992. Three unique people: Arula Roy, a former IAS officer who gave up her IAS service to go and talk of democracy to villagers; Nikhil Day, a young lawyer from America, Indian lawyer who had graduated in the US, came back and said, "I want to work in the villages." And Shankar Singh, a person who belonged to Dev Dumri village in Rajasthan. These three people got together and explained what is democracy, what are the citizens' rights. One evening at a chauraha, people were sitting around and complaining about what is wrong. ये वीडियो पैसा खाता है, सरकार का पैसा आता नहीं है, करप्शन है, ऐसा है, वैसा है. This survey of mine shows that all Indian citizens crib for 3 to 4 hours every month. But what is wrong? रास्ता बराबर नहीं है, पुलिस हफ्ता खाता है, मिनिस्टर ऐसा करता है, this minister, chief minister cannot make up his cabinet at all. Former prime minister did not speak, this prime minister मन की बात करता रहता है, and so on and so forth. It changes nothing, but anyway, so this was happening. And there was an old lady of 80, illiterate, who said, "I can't read and write, but all of you can read and write. Why don't you go and take a look at the hisab in the BDO's office? And then you'll know whether money is being spent properly or there is any corruption." Everybody said, "Who will show us the accounts?" This was 1992 I'm talking about. We have no authority. How will anyone show us the accounts and the books? And this old lady made a statement which is something phenomenal. She said, "Ye lokshahi hai aur main is desh ki rani hoon. Agar main is desh ki rani hoon to jo paisa kharch hota hai wo mera paisa hai. और अगर पैसा मेरा है तो हिसाब लेना मेरा अधिकार है." ग्रेट स्टेटमेंट ऑफ डेमोक्रेसी. दिस पीपल वेंट टू द बीडीओज ऑफिस, आस्क्ड टू सी द अकाउंट्स एंड पेपर्स फॉर द लास्ट टू इयर्स. द बीडीओ थ्रू देम आउट. ही सेड, "तुम समझते क्या हो, तुम क्या कलेक्टर हो, मिनिस्टर हो, गेट आउट." ही जस्ट हैड टू थ्रो आउट ऑफ द ऑफिस. दे स्टार्टेड अ धरना. The collector came, the minister came, ultimately the concept was accepted that yes, these papers have to be shown to these citizens. And thereby started a slogan which has become the standard slogan of the right to information movement across the nation. The slogan is, "Hamara paisa, hamara hisab." Aap log bolenge mere saath?
Yes.
Sure. पुना में देखते छाती में कितना दम है. I will say हमारा पैसा, you will say हमारा हिसाब. हमारा पैसा,
हमारा हिसाब.
हमारा पैसा,
हमारा हिसाब.
Very good. Now I am talking to the Badshahs and Begums of India. Thank you. Okay, now we'll take a look at some of the provisions of the law. In India, we had state acts. The first state to have such a law was Tamil Nadu in 1996. After that, 9 states had such acts. Maharashtra got a good act in 2003. But in 2005, the National Act was passed by Parliament and this applies to the whole nation. What does information mean? The description is given there. Information means any material, any form, etc., etc., etc. In simple terms, information is what exists. If it does not exist, it's not information. Therefore, if you say, what is the meaning of this law, unless there is a record describing the meaning of the law, the PIO is not supposed to answer you anything. If an illegal building is there and you say, is there a building here, and on record there is no building, the PIO will say there is no building. To illustrate this, just understand, this is RTI's right to information, not right to interrogation. If you cannot say, if I apply for a water connection, what will happen? There will be nothing on record showing, if I apply for admission to this college, what will happen? What has to exist is a record which is relevant. That is what information is. Who has to give information? The law defines public authority. All public authorities have to give information under right to information. Public authority is not state. State and public authority are different. Parliament knew the word public state, but did not use the word state. Consciously they use this word. Public authority means any authority or body or institution of self-government established or constituted by or under the constitution, by any other law made by parliament, by any other law made by state legislature. In simple terms, everything that we call government is covered. Central government, state government, municipal corporations, municipalities, panchayats, all these bodies will fall in ABC. D, by notification issued or order made by the appropriate government. Therefore, deemed universities which are created by notification specifically are covered by the RTI Act. And includes any body owned, controlled or substantially financed, non-government organization substantially financed directly or indirectly by funds provided by the appropriate government. Jab mera paisa lagta hai, hisab dena mera adhikar hai. If it's controlled by government or administered by government directly, it's not regulatory. It has to be direct control, pervasive control as I call it. By this definition, a normal registered cooperative society is not covered under the RTI Act unless it is substantially financed. Or in the case of cooperative societies, sometimes an administrator is appointed. Then it is controlled by the government. Otherwise, it is not. Substantial finance is a key word for most organizations, which we call as private, which are actually covered. Have some of you heard about the Mumbai Metro One Private Limited? No? Okay. There is an organization called Mumbai Metro One Private Limited in Mumbai, which has made the first metro from Warsaw going up to Ghatkopar. In Mumbai, if I ask anyone, they will say the company is a Reliance company. I knew there was some government finance in this, so I asked them for some information and the right to information. And they said, Mr. Gandhi, don't you understand English? Mumbai Metro One, private limited. Private limited, tumhala samjat nahi ka? So I dug a little deeper, and this is what I found. Government has put in 780 crore rupees into Mumbai Metro One Private Limited. 780 crores. 600 crores of land has been given Phukat. Project karne ko dena padega. Reliance has put in 380 crores. But it's called a Reliance company. Why? Equity is 74% Reliance, 26% government. Jadoo na? If you all learn this trick, we'll all become rich overnight. Reliance with 380 crores, government with 780 crores and 600 crores of land is the junior partner. This is done by, lawyers should learn these tricks. This is done by a simple device of labeling. 780 crores of the government's money is given two labels. 600 crores has given the label of viability gap funding. To make the project viable, 600 crores has to be given. Equity of government is 180 crores. Equity of Reliance is 380 crores. Therefore, 26% government and 74%. They are now, of course, giving information to RTI because we went up to the commission and got a decision accordingly. But most public-private partnerships are public authorities and must give information under RTI to you, the citizen, the lord of this nation. What is right to information? Right to information means the right to information accessible under this Act, which is held by or under the control of any public authority and includes the right to inspection of work, documents, records. You can inspect work. You can inspect documents. You can inspect records. You can apply and say, I want to inspect the files relating to ABC. Supposing there are potholes on the road, the government record or the municipal record is unlikely to record that. If you can say, I want to inspect the road, you can do an inspection with the government, with a municipal officer, take photographs, make a report, and then that becomes part of the government record. Taking notes, extracts of certified copies of documents or records. This is what is normally done, taking photocopies of documents, taking extracts of documents, etc. taking certified samples of material. If you believe a government hospital is using fake drugs, you can take a sample, get it tested. If you believe the concrete being used in a road project is of poor quality, you can take a sample, get it tested. You can get a food grain sample from a government godown and get it tested. That is also part of this. Obtaining information in the form of biscuits, droppings, etc., etc. A very important part is CCTV footage. Today, lots of places on the roads, etc., have CCTV footages. Police stations also are supposed to have CCTV footages. So a very important source of information can be CCTV footages. It tells you what happened at a particular time. And according to a Bombay High Court judgment, CCTV footage of all police stations has to be kept intact for about 2 years from that date. The most important section of the Right to Information Act is the shortest one. Subject to the provisions of this act, all citizens shall have the right to information. Who can have the right to information? All citizens of India. Can any information be denied? What do you think? Yes. Okay. Let us look at it objectively. We said democracy is rule of the people, for the people, by the people. Therefore, you are ruler of this country? Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. If I am ruler of this country, the government belongs to me. The nation belongs to me. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. If the nation belongs to me and the government belongs to me, every table, tube light, chair, every car, tank, gun in the government belongs to me. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. If I like a car, can I take it home?
No.
Why? Why can I not take it home? Anyone has a bag here? Anyone with a bag or a computer? Can you take it home? Yes. Do you need the principal's permission to take it home? Why? It's mine. So if the government is mine and the caste belongs to me, why can't I take it home?
So it belongs to every citizen.
You are right. I can't take it home because it is in partnership with 130 crore other Indians. But just remember this carefully. The files, the information on the files and computers of the government also belongs to me. Therefore, all that information I have a right on, I have ownership of. Some information may be denied based on the law, because it is believed that greater good will occur if some of the information is denied. But the default mode is information belongs to me. Mahiti mazi ahe. I own that. Mi malik ahe. And you start thinking about these things not as we, ya hum, main. I am the Badshah or Begum of this nation. At the end of this talk, I am hoping RTI ki to thodi charcha kar lenge. I'll hopefully explain this to you and you'll use RTI. But more importantly, when you get out of that door, go out with the feeling that you are the Badshah or Begum of this nation. If you start believing that, as Badshah or Begum, you have rights, you have authority, you also have duties. Shivaji Maharaj did not only say, I am ruler. If something was wrong, it was his responsibility to correct it. So if you are the ruler of this nation, it is your responsibility to correct things that are wrong. Now let's do a small quiz. Main bahut bolte rehta hun. Let us see whether you are understanding what I am saying. And if you don't understand, the fault is mine, not yours really. Are these seeking information? If I apply for a water connection, will it be granted to me? No. There will be nothing on record. Until I apply for the water connection and the file moves, there will be no record of whether if Shailesh Gandhi applies for a water connection, it will be given to him or not. So that's not asking for information. Why does Swami Vivekananda Road or Senapati Bapat Road have many potholes? No, this is also not asking information. because there will be no record there saying why it has potholes. Think of a record in existence when you are asking for information. Can a sample be taken from a government godown? Louder!
Yes!
Can you file an RTI application with Nirav Modi's companies?
No. It's a private person.
Because though it's our money, it was theoretically given through a bank. Okay. Can you file an RTI application with an elite school?
Yes.
Very good. 25% of RTI you know now. Heart of the public authority is what is called Section 4. Every public authority should maintain all its records duly catalogued and indexed, etc., etc. All records should be kept properly and subject to availability of resources computerized and connected through a network all over the country on different systems so that access to such records is facilitated. You are the Badshah or Begum of this nation. Why should you even have to ask for information? Most information should be available to you automatically. Badshah ya Begum ko poochne nahi jana chahiye. That was the promise of the RTI Act. And I'd like to draw your attention to the latter part of this, which says availability of computerized and connected through a network all over the country on different systems so that access to such network is facilitated. Let me share a simple thing with you. When an average citizen goes to a government office for some complaint, some application, some representation, a standard answer is file bhetat nahi. 100 rupees dile ta file bhetate. 500 रुपए दिले तो रिकॉर्ड बदली होऊन जाते 1000 रुपए दिले तो फाइल गायब होऊन जाणार आणि थोड़े लाख रुपए दिले तो मंत्रालय मध्ये आग लागून जाणार ऑल्सो लुक एट इट लाइक दिस इफ अ फाइल इज मेड इन पुणे म्युनिसिपल कॉर्पोरेशन इन वन ऑफ द वार्ड्स एंड हैज टू गो टू मंत्रालय इट हैज टू बी फिजिकली टेकन टू मंत्रालय. From there, if it has to go to, let's say, Delhi, it has to physically go to Delhi. Just imagine how this governmental process works. Hey, Brahmanda, kabhi to kabhi ek mahina lagna. Because for each file, there cannot be a courier running. Of course, if we had that, India would have no employment problem. Everybody would be employed. But that is not practical. And in this journey, this pilgrimage, records can be changed, records can go missing, files can go missing easily. What does not go missing is a surprise. Whereas today all government offices have computers. In fact, we give computers even to school children nowadays. So that's not a problem. Interlinking, most places in the country are interlinked by network. Most places, there will be a few rare places that will not be networked. Just imagine if that file was made electronic. Today, all typing is done on the computer. The computer is used as an electric typewriter rather than as a computer. If by internet the same file had to travel from Pune to Mantralay and Mantralay to Delhi electronically and come back, it could all finish within 1 hour. What today would take over a month with great possibilities of changing things. And a computer system, it is possible to ensure that no change can be made. And if change is made, what it was before can be there. The backup of what's done in Pune could be in Hyderabad or Bangalore. So that even if an earthquake hits Pune, the records will remain. This is not being done. And this is what I want to share with you. If this is done, transparency, accountability become easy. 30% of India's corruption would go away by this simple thing. Today we spend a few thousand crores on paper, files and igatta, which would be saved. You would save a few thousand trees also. And a lot of money. And entire thing can become efficient. Now, fair enough, I have a right to information. I have understood what is information, who can give me information. Who do I apply to? The law says every office of a public authority, every office has to have a public information officer who's a person who's doing some other job as well but is also designated as a public information officer. If the public information officer does not have the information, he must get it from others and give it. if it is not in that office at all. The law says, can he return the information application and give it to you? The law says no. You are the Badshah or Begum of this nation. The public information officer must transfer the RTI application to the right public authority within 5 days. So therefore, no RTI application can be returned saying, Amchakade nahi, dusra thikani ja. They will have to transfer it. Should you apply? Think carefully, where do you believe the record is likely to exist? And apply there to the public information officer. Do I need to know the name of the public information officer? The answer is no. Write to the public information officer of a particular office where you believe the information is likely to be. There has to be a public information officer. If there's no public information officer, there has to be somebody who's looking after that position. Just as if I want to write to the principal of the law college, I don't need the name of the person. I can write principal, so-and-so law college, and there will be somebody who will receive the letter. A person who desires to obtain any information under this act shall make a request in writing or through electronic means in English or Hindi or in the official language of the area in which the application is being made. In Maharashtra, it will be Marathi. An applicant making request for information shall not be required to give any reason for requesting the information or any other personal details except those that may be necessary for contacting him. Now, the law has this provision, but does it appear reasonable? A lot of people say, including the Chief Justice of India, that this is not a reasonable proposition. Kai karan shiva asal mangaycha, kai vaatte tumhala? Should there be reasons for asking for information or no? Louder.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Anyone who said yes? Yes. Why should there be reasons? Anybody can ask, right? The bad guy can see. Does he need to give somebody a reason for opening? If in your house you have a cupboard, you need to give anybody a reason. You have to give reasons to your parents. Ki main kabat ka khol to.
But if he doesn't have a reason, then you will not open the bank.
Look at it like this. I own that information. I own that office. If you own something, do you need a reason? Also understand one other thing. You own that information. Start developing that concept. I own the information, therefore I don't need to give reasons. Besides, right to information is part of Article 19(1)(a) of the Constitution, which gives me freedom of speech and expression. Supreme Court in various decisions has established, and there is no argument on this, freedom of speech and expression under Article 19(1)(a) includes freedom to speak, to publish, and right to information. All these come under Article 19(1)(a). If somebody says, I need a reason to ask for information, then I will have to give a reason before speaking. I'll be asked to give a reason before publishing anything. All these three are at one level. Therefore, any restriction on one has to be followed by a restriction on others. There cannot be selective restriction on one and not on the other. Because I own the information, I need to give no reasons for asking for information. Ideally, the government should provide information to me in a manner that I don't need to ask also. The fact that I need to ask is troubling the owner of the information. It should be easily available. When an application is made to a public authority, which I told you within 5 days it has to be transferred. Okay, information has to be provided within 30 days. Application fee rupees 10. In Maharashtra, the simplest way of paying the application fee of 10 rupees is to take a court fee stamp of 10 rupees and stick it on a paper. You need no form. Any simple paper is your form. In Maharashtra, there is a format that you need to follow. Central government has no format. For central government organizations, court fee stamp will not work. A 10 rupee Indian postal order must be attached. And if the information is, let's say, 50 pages, the PIO can ask you to pay at the rate of 2 rupees per page, which is 100 rupees, and you will have to pay that amount. After that, you will get the information. On receipt of a request under Section 6, PIO shall, as expeditiously as possible, and in any case within 30 days of the receipt of the request, either provide the information on payment of such fee as may be prescribed, or reject the request for any of the reasons specified in sections 8 or 9. Default mode, as I said, is information must be provided. If information is refused, it has to be justified by section 8 or section 9. Section 8 we'll deal with a little detail. Section 9 is covering copyright. Supposing you ask censor board for a DVD of the film, in any film, they cannot give it to you because it would infringe somebody's copyright. But apart from that, section 8 one gives 10 clauses on based on which information can be denied. Nobody can say this is confidential, hence I will not give it to you. Nobody can say this is sensitive, therefore I will not give it to you. He or she has to justify by one of those 10 clauses of section 8.1. Where a request has been rejected under subsection 1, a PR shall communicate the person making the request the reasons for such rejection. The period within which an appeal against such rejection may be preferred, which is 30 days, particulars of the first appellate authority. So there is a senior officer in each department who's designated as the first appellate authority. And if you are not satisfied with the answer or if you receive no reply from a PIO, you can file a first appeal with the first appellate authority. And if you are not satisfied with that, you can file a second appeal with the Information Commission, which is the final appellate authority in this case. 30-day period, I just want to explain. PIO receives RT application as day 1. After 8 days, PIO sends letter asking additional fees. 30-day clock stops. Additional fees paid, 30-day clock starts. Information sent after Y days, X plus Y less than or equal to 30 days. In case of a transfer, information must be provided in 35 days. True or false? If the information is with a different PIO, the RT application can be returned. True or false? Great. Jor se yaar. I always wonder whether I put people to sleep or not. So this is my way of checking that people have not gone to sleep. Reasons have to be given for seeking information. Great. PIO must respond in the language the applicant wants. No. There's nothing in the law that says the PIO must respond. The PIO will also respond in one of the three languages, Hindi, English, or the local language of the state. NGO is eligible to seek information in RTI.
Yes. Yes.
No, citizens only. NGOs, companies, corporate bodies are not eligible. It applies only to a citizen, a natural citizen of the country. PIO can demand rupees. After 30 days if the information is given, no further fees can be charged. So if after 35 days a PIO is giving you information, even if it's 1,000 pages, he cannot charge you 2,000 rupees for that. Let's understand this. Fundamental rights must go into our bloodstream. It must be Rako Uthaya, mera fundamental right hai. You can't define my fundamental right. You cannot tread on my fundamental right. RTI is a fundamental right of citizens under Article 19(1)(a) of the Constitution, which guarantees freedom of speech and expression. Can any constraint be put on my fundamental right?
Yes.
By the Constitution only. By no law can my fundamental right be constrained. If fundamental rights have to be constrained, it has only been through the Constitution of India or an amendment to the Constitution of India. Article 19(2) lists some permissible restrictions, which permits reasonable restrictions in the interest of the sovereignty and integrity of India, the security of the state, friendly relations with foreign states, public order, decency or morality, or in relation to contempt of court, defamation or inciting to an offence. These are covered under Section 8(1) of the law. But they have to be within the domain of Article 19(2). They cannot go beyond 19(2). When interpreting, if there is any doubt, I submit you must look at 19(2) because you cannot constrain my right beyond what the Constitution permits. Now this, understand, these are the only reasons based on which your information request can be refused. Notwithstanding anything contained in this Act, there shall be no obligation to give any citizen information, disclosure of which would prejudicially affect the sovereignty and integrity of India, the security, strategic, scientific or economic interests of the state, relation with foreign state, or lead to incitement of an offence. For example, the Indian Army is also covered under RTI. But if you said, I want details of where the army formations are, or where the guns are, or how much ammunition is there, these would be refused, and similar information of that nature. But also understand, the PIO must not only quote a section, he must give some reasoning, maybe in brief, as to how that section applies to that. B, information which has been expressly forbidden to be published by any court of law or tribunal, or the disclosure of which may constitute contempt of court. Based on 8.1b, can information on subjudice matters be given? Yes or no? अभी सब सब लोग सो गए यार मैं बोलता हूँ तुम्हें कोई जवाब नहीं देता है कैन मैटर्स एट आर सब जुडिस इंफॉर्मेशन बी गिवन हाउ मेनी नोज लिफ्ट योर हैंड्स ओनली वन ओके हाउ मेनी यसेस सब जुडिस वर्ड वॉज नोन टू पार्लियामेंट पार्लियामेंट डिड नॉट यूज द वर्ड सब जुडिस Read there is anything written that it matters or subjudice. What it says is expressly forbidden by a court of law. There has to be an express order saying this information shall not be given, shall not be revealed. Otherwise, all information default mode is meri hai. Mana karne ke time pe agar aapko kuch mana karta hai, aapke kuch hai to, you should feel the same thing when somebody refuses information to you. Unless the law says, if the law says subjudice. One would have to respect that. The law did not say sub judice. The law said expressly forbidden by a court of law or tribunal. Information, the disclosure of which would cause a breach of privilege of parliament or the state legislature. What kind of information is that? For example, information that, let's say budget papers. If you ask for the budget papers before the budget is presented to parliament or state legislature, that would be denied because of breach of privilege. I'll give you an instance, an interesting incident. Adarsh Commission Ghotala, are you all aware of?
Yes.
Ghotala sabko maalum hota hai. So the Adarsh Commission Ghotala was there and there was a lot of furor. Government's standard technique of when there is something like this is to appoint a commission of inquiry. A commission bitha do, wo karte rahega kaam. Actually, the Commissions of Inquiry Act requires that within 6 months the report should be given. But usually all these commissions extend their periods. 6 months ka, 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. Nanavati Commission took 17 years. So 17 years ke baad wo report ko kya karega, koi pata nahi. Anyway, the Adarsh Commission report was given in 2 years. The report mentioned names of ministers and senior officials as being responsible for the scam. And therefore the government decided to just put it in the cupboard and forget all about it. They didn't put it in the legislature, they didn't put it anywhere. After 7 months, I asked for a copy of that report. PIO refused, saying breach of privilege of legislature, we've not placed it before legislature, so how can you get it? I argued that within 6 months, the Commission of Inquiry Act says you must present it on the floor of the legislature. You have not done this. Once you breach the privilege of legislature, you can't say I'm breaching privilege, giving it to me. The first appellate authority also refused. I went to the Commission. The government realized it and untenable stand. So what they did is they presented it to legislature and sent me a copy. All commissions of inquiry reports can be accessed after 6 months. No matter what the government wants, tumhare paise se bana hai aur tumhare ko wo adhikar hai lene ka. The information including commercial confidence, trade secrets or intellectual property, the disclosure of which would harm the competitive position of a third party. There's a public interest override which we'll deal with a little later. Supposing you ask FDA for a copy of the formulation of Coca-Cola. It could not be given to you because it would damage somebody's commercial interest and harm somebody's competitive interest. Two conditions have to be shown. It must be of a nature of commercial confidence, which is information which is not easily shared. B, it should be information that will damage somebody's competitive interest. Quite often that is not shown. To give an example, Indian Railways cannot claim this for any information relating to it because it has no competition. Air India or Bank of India can because they have competition. So unless a tender paper or tender quotes before the tender is opened cannot be shared. Once the tender is awarded, There is nobody's competitive interest who can be hurt, and therefore it should be given. This is special for law students. Information available to a person is fiduciary relationship. What is fiduciary?
Based on trust.
All of us have trust that nobody will pick up a gun and start shooting at each other. Do we have that trust? Are we in a fiduciary relationship? Trust is one element, my friends. And on this I can speak with considerable authority. I had given 10 decisions when I was a commissioner. RBI refused to give information regarding major defaulters, bank greetings, audit reports of banks, inspection reports of banks, etc. I had ordered that all this has to be given. RBI had claimed that this is held by them in a fiduciary relationship. I said no. What are standard fiduciary relationships? Lawyer client, banker customer, doctor patient, etc. What are the characteristics of this? Someone gives information to somebody with superior knowledge for his or her benefit. I go to a lawyer and talk to him and give him information for my benefit. I go to a doctor for my benefit. I go to a banker for my benefit. That person is not supposed to disclose this information to anybody else. But information that he or she gives me, I can disclose to anybody. If a lawyer gives me advice or a doctor gives me advice, I can go and show it to 100 other people. And fiduciary relationship is a one-way relationship, not a two-way relationship. Two, there is no legal requirement for me to give that information to that person. I can go to my lawyer, hire that lawyer, but I may not give any information. There is no legal obligation at all. It is a matter of choice. I go to my lawyer, banker or doctor because I trust him. You are right. I have trust that this person will give me right advice. Even if somebody says, "Main samne se paisa dunga," I may not go to someone because unless I trust him. Trust is one element, but trust is not the only element. Most information with government records is not because I trust the government. I may not trust the government, but I have to give it because there is a regulation. There is a financial law that requires me to give that information, and I have to give it jolly well. I have no choice in the matter. I have no choice of whom to give it to. If I have to give information to RBI, I have to give information to RBI. If college has to give certain information to Pune University, it has to give that information. Most information is not held in a fiduciary relationship. The only information that is held in fiduciary relationship, then why is this clause there? For example, if my account is in State Bank of India, and you tell State Bank of India, give me details of Mr. Gandhi's account, they can't give it to you because it's held in fiduciary relationship of Shailesh Gandhi. If I go to a government hospital and give details about my health, you can't access my records from there because they hold it in a fiduciary relationship. Those are the only elements, but most of the government records are not held in fiduciary relationship. Information received in confidence from foreign government. This is the only place the word confidence has been used. And this is because international relations would be impossible unless people believe that their correspondence and communications would not be shared. Information, the disclosure of which would endanger the life or physical safety of any person, or identify the source of information or assistance given in confidence for the enforcement of law. This is obvious. Supposing you've given a complaint about somebody and someone says, "I want to know," and that person is a mafia don. Revealing the information is likely to harm your physical or life. Information which would impede the process of investigation or apprehension or prosecution of offenders. If an investigation is ongoing, can information be given? Louder! Does the law say that? Read the law carefully, my friends. Does the law say that? The law did not say when an investigation is ongoing, information shall not be given. It said impede the process of investigation. Therefore, it has to be shown that giving the information will impede the process of investigation in some manner. 70% of the times, information about investigation is being sought because a person files a complaint and there is no progress of the complaint. They are doing nothing. So a person files a complaint and they use this and say, "We will not give it to you." A simple argument is, if I have filed a complaint, I will not want to impede the process. In fact, I want to further the process, I want to push the process. Carefully look at the word impede and all laws. Please look at each word of a law. That is really the essence of law. Cabinet papers, including records of deliberations of councils of ministers, secretaries and other officers, provided that the decisions of councils of ministers, the reasons thereof and the material on the basis of which the decisions were taken, shall be made public after the decision has been taken and the matter is complete or over. This is a unique distinction, exemption. Up to a certain point, information is exempt. After the decision is taken, the information must be made public. For example, when bills are presented before Parliament, before the bill is presented, the matter must be kept secret, all cabinet notes and all discussions. Once the bill is presented, it's the property of the House. The matter is complete or over, and this information must be shared with public. Clearly speaking, when a bill is presented before Parliament, citizens must get a right to see whether this is right or not. You are the owners. You are the rulers of this nation. You must get a right to decide whether it's right or wrong. You must get a right to discuss, to give your objections, to give your submissions to members of Parliament to set it right. This is the most popular exemption of all. 81J. Information which relates to personal information, the disclosure of which has no relationship to any public activity or interest, or which would cause unwarranted invasion of the privacy of the individual, unless the PI is satisfied that the larger public interest justifies the disclosure of such information. Provided that the information which cannot be denied to Parliament or a state legislature shall not be denied to any person. A lot of people say that all personal information therefore can be denied. Your name is personal. The colour of your hair is personal, your age is personal. If you give a letter, if you give an application to a government for a job, that is personal, relates to a natural person. All personal information has not been barred by RTI Act. It has to, if it is personal information, it may qualify. First, your law college cannot claim personal information. A corporation cannot, institution cannot have personal information. Only a natural person can have personal information. Further, the disclosure of which has no relationship to any public activity or interest. If you file for a government job, you apply for a government job, is that a public activity or a private activity? If you apply for a government job, is it a public activity or a private activity? Private. Okay, so somebody will say it's public, somebody will say it's private. Or which would cause unwarranted invasion of the privacy of the individual. What is privacy? Fundamental right of citizens, right? Everyone knows that? The Puttaswamy judgment is unique. 9 judges sat together, gave a 547-page judgment and said privacy is a fundamental right of citizens. But he did not say what is privacy. During the whole judgment, there is great philosophy. But privacy, kya hai, kaise pata chalega? How is a citizen or a PIO to decide what is privacy? The Supreme Court in its wisdom says, it will be decided on a case-to-case basis. So for everything, you go to the Supreme Court and get the definition. Certainty of law is an international principle which is fundamental. Otherwise, neither citizens nor government officers can move as per the law. We were aware of this confusion likely to be there, and therefore we gave an acid test. Provided that the information which cannot be denied to Parliament or state legislature shall not be denied to any person. The only way this can be interpreted is that whoever denies information to a citizen using 81J must make a statement that I would not give this information to Parliament or state legislature. Let us look at section Article 19.2 once again. In that, which are the words that can relate to privacy, can you figure out? Sovereignty and integrity of India, can it relate to privacy? Security of the state, federalism, foreign states, public order. Decency or morality are the only two words that will relate to privacy. Sexual preferences, not to be revealed. Suppose there is a nude photograph in the government records, not to be revealed. A pornographic film, not to be revealed. Details of a rape, not to be revealed. This is information which will violate decency or morality, and therefore it should not be given to Parliament also. The whole purpose of the exemptions is because it is believed some greater harm will accrue to somebody. If I give information to Parliament, it becomes public knowledge. Therefore, if I can give information to Parliament, I must give it to a citizen. But remember one thing, citizen is not entitled to only information which is to be given to Parliament. It's the other way around. I legitimize Parliament. I legitimize the legislature. It is because of your vote that somebody sits there. They don't legitimize you. You are a citizen of this nation. You have your fundamental rights. And the fundamental rights are not just citizens' rights. They are of any person residing in India. Any human being. These are basic human rights. 8.2 says, notwithstanding anything in the Official Secrets Act, nor any of the exemptions permissible in accordance with subsection 1, a public authority may allow access to information if public interest in disclosure outweighs the harm to the protected interest. Public interest needs to be shown only if there is an exemption. If no exemption applies, no public interest needs to be shown. But if an exemption is claimed, and you claim that there is a larger public interest, for example, Nirav Modi's companies. If you apply to Punjab National Bank, they are likely to say if they hold the information, fiduciary relationship. But you could claim that there is a large fraud, and therefore there is a larger public interest in disclosure, and it could be considered and information could be disclosed. Section 10, where a request for access to information is rejected on the ground that is in relation to information which is exempt from disclosure, then notwithstanding anything contained in this Act, access may be provided to that part of the record. You can severe, if something is exempt, if you really practice this properly, information that is exempt can be severed and the rest of the information should be given to you. Yes. If a matter is subjudice, information shall not be provided, true or false? Great. No commercial information shall be provided. No. Only if it is shown that it will harm somebody's competitive interest. Just because it's commercial confidence will not be adequate. Confidential information shall not be provided. False. Confidence word is only when it is from foreign government. Nobody can say confidential hai, bakwas hai. Nobody can say this is sensitive information, bakwas hai. Nobody can say process is not complete, bakwas hai. Only the exemptions of section 8.1 apply. A PR can reject an application without giving any reason. An applicant must give reasons for seeking information. All personal information is exempted. If information is confidential, it will not be given. True or false? अरे बादशाह और बेगम जैसे बात करो फटाक फॉल्स ओके सेक्शन 19 डील्स विद अपील्स फर्स्ट अपील टू फर्स्ट अपीलेंट अथॉरिटी इन 30 डेज फॉर नॉट गेटिंग इन्फॉर्मेशन इनकम्प्लीट इन्फॉर्मेशन और रॉन्ग इन्फॉर्मेशन फर्स्ट अपीलेंट अथॉरिटी शुड डिसाइड इन 30 डेज ही कैन एक्सटेंड बाय 15 डेज सो मे बी 45 डेज इफ रिजल्ट ऑफ फर्स्ट अपील नॉट सैटिस्फैक्ट्री फाइल सेकंड अपील टू द कमीशन विद इन 90 डेज Section 19.5, onus on the PIO that denial of information was justified. PIO has to justify why he does not give you information. You do not have to justify why you want information at all. Section 20 is the teeth of the Act. This is the reason why this law works. If information denied without reasonable cause, Commission must penalize the PIO, deem PIO to be ₹250 per day of delay after giving an opportunity of explaining. Maximum penalty ₹25,000. Commission can also recommend disciplinary action against the officer and compensation to be paid to an applicant. Section 22 is very important. Most laws get confused because you say this law says this, somebody says another law says that, a third law says that. So it's RTI is the only, not the only, but one of those laws which says that it supersedes all earlier laws. RTI is relating to giving of information. The provisions of this Act shall have any effect notwithstanding anything that inconsistent therewith contained in the Official Secrets Act and any other law for the time being in force or in any instrument having effect by virtue of any law other than this Act. Therefore, nobody can say under Evidence Act this cannot be done. Under Companies Law this cannot be done. Under Cooperative Societies Act this cannot be done. As far as giving of information is concerned, only the RTI Act is relevant. Supreme Court rules also don't matter. IT application information should be obtained in 30 days. If no information provided or unsatisfactory information, first appeal to be filed within 30 days of response or 60 days in case of no response. First appellate authority hearing order within 45 days. If unsatisfactory order or no response, second appeal to commission within 90 days. The last one. If the PR refuses to give the information, the applicant must file an appeal with the information commission. You must file a first appeal in the first appellate authority. The second appeal lies with the information commission. So the first appeal must go to the appellate authority. Information which is not to be displayed as per the Evidence Act, Supreme Court rule shall not be given. Great. RTI application was filed on 1st January, was rejected on 10th January. The first appeal can be filed on 25th February. False. Within 30 days of rejection, you must file the appeal. A form for filing RTI application must be obtained from government office. False. I said freedom to publish, which is freedom of press, free speech, and right to information, amongst other things. My right to singing is also covered. Even if I sing very badly, I can sing. The fact that people will throw stones at me is a different consequence. We all say that freedom of media is very important. It's the fourth pillar of democracy. Why is freedom of media so important? Media is a business like any other business. Why is freedom of media so important? Yes, what is it? Say it loud.
Because it provides information.
It provides information to?
Public at
large. Me.
Public at large.
Public at large. Public at large to people. Therefore, if the freedom of media is important because it gives information to me, what should come first? Freedom of media or right to information? Start believing this. When somebody talks, RTI mein aisa hona chahiye, waisa hona chahiye, bolo publishing ko pehle band karo. Band karne ko nahi bol raha hu main. But it is on par. This is not being understood, this is not being, strong narrative is being built. Ki RTI bekaar hai. Everybody in power dislikes transparency for themselves. They want it for everybody else. You should be transparent, but no. Me, I don't need to be transparent. We need to, as citizens, defend our fundamental right to information because that is our biggest tool for establishing a true democracy. This is an RTI application which is very famous in a certain manner. This is a format also. This was a young boy from Vidarbha who in 2006 came to Mumbai looking for a job. He was not able to make ends meet where he was staying. So he came to Mumbai. Where did he stay? He stayed in a hut with a chacha of his. He was going around looking for a job. And there was an RTI workshop being held in the Basti. People like me hold RTI workshops in all kinds of places, colleges, societies, clubs. He sat down, understood that any plain piece of paper can be his form. He needs to only fill up as per a format. Put a 10 rupee court fee stamp on that. Address it to the public information officer, and he must seek what is on record, not why and what for. Having understood all this, he moved on. Then he got a job somewhere. After a little time, he went to file for a ration card application. He went to the rationing office, filed his application. As he was going out of the door, the pune met him, and the pune said, "Tumhara ration card paisega." He said, "Oh, kya satish the form bharla." The pune said, "Chah paani lage." The boy said, "Theek hai, aapko chai pila dunga." The pune said, "Nahi, chai pilane ki baat nahi kar raha hu." Then he said, "What do you mean?" The pune said, "You have to pay 2000 rupees, then you get your ration card." This boy, without batting an eyelid, made a statement that always makes me feel proud. He said, "Main ghoos nahi dunga. I shall not give a bribe." The pune shrugged. Gaon se aaya hai, bevkoof hai, isko is jalan mein ration card nahi milna hai. Jao, tum. Tumhara kaam nahi hai ration card lene. This boy went away. He He found out in the Basti people were coming from villages and applying for ration cards, and they were all paying 2,000 rupees and getting their ration cards in about 40-45 days. He understood how to use RTI, so he filed his RTI application. It was in Marathi, but I have converted it to English. I have given an application for a ration card on 5th August 2006, photocopy of receipt attached. I want the following information. Progress of application, giving which officer had my application on which date, to whom did he forward it on which date. This will include the notings and comments of all the officers. Attested photocopies of notings will be provided. And I said, jawab kya dete? It is not moved at all. Because chaha paani nahi dilan. Asa ta liun devu shakat nahi kuni. Two, I want a list of ration cards issued in the last 3 months, during the dates on which the applications were made and the dates on which the ration cards were issued. This would reveal that others had been given ration cards and the whole thing was a corruption den. So next day the pune came to his house and said, aapko saamne bulaya hai. He went to the rationing office. The rationing officer saw him and said, "Arey arey, yancha sathi kursi aala." And he answered, "Ration card ghevun ya ani ek cup chaha ani ek glass pani ghevun ya." He did not give chai pani, he got chai pani instead. And that one cup of tea, according to me, was respect for the individual sovereign citizen of this nation. That is what he established. It is not just getting a ration card or just a cup of tea. He got respect as the sovereign citizen of this India, and I believe this is the main reason why RTI is important. It establishes, builds a relationship in which the citizen can get respect and get empowered to take accountability for his government. Another application I'd like to talk to you about is my own application. On a particular day, on the front page of Times of India, I saw a photograph of citizens demonstrating at Marine Drive in Mumbai because police constable More had raped a minor, and they were demonstrating saying action should be taken. Right. On the same day, on page 5, was a small news item. This news item spoke about Inspector Prakash Avare. It said, "Police Inspector Prakash Avare of Mumbai Police had raped a minor the earlier year. The evidence was clear. He was suspended from service. Case was filed against him in court. And he was acquitted by the court because enough evidence was not presented." The report said Police Inspector Prakash Avare had been reinstated in service. When we read something like this, we all feel angry. I also felt angry. What can I do? So I filed this RTI application. According to a news report in the Times of India dated 29th April 06, Inspector Prakash Avare was accused of raping a minor girl in September 2005. He was acquitted by the Sessions Court in February and has been reinstated in service. I want a photocopy of the order reinstating him along with the file notings based on which the decision was taken. The PIO refused this. I filed a first appeal. I am also showing you the first appeal. This is the format. For Maharashtra, for first appeal and second appeal, there is a court fee stamp of 20 rupees that is required. Central government, there is no appellate fee. No, the first page. Grounds for appeal. Facts of the case. I had asked for information regarding the reinstatement of Inspector Prakash Avare as per the attached application. The PIO first sent me a letter saying that the information will be provided by Baikala Police Station. PIO Baikala replied by his letter of 16-5 that the information could not be provided as exempt under section 81H, which exempts information which would impede the process of investigation or apprehension of prosecution of offenders. Grounds for appeal. The PIO has not shown how providing the information could impede any investigation. In fact, no investigation has been held since Prakash Avare has been reinstated. The rejection is without any basis in law. I went for the first appellate hearing. There was a very good Deputy Commissioner of Police. And the reason I am explaining this to you is, there are good officers also, but we need to do something to nudge them. So this chap said, at that time I was not a commissioner, I was just an average citizen. He said, "Mr. Gandhi, what can we do? The court has released him. Hum kya kar sakte?" I said, "From my perspective, I am only asking for records. I am not asking for anything else. I will hold it to citizens. These are the reasons on file, etc. But let me give you my perspective. There are two possibilities. Either Inspector Prakash Avare was innocent. If he is innocent, somebody framed him. Then action should be taken against whoever framed him. Alternately, he is guilty. If he is guilty, reinstating him is doing great disservice to people, to police and the nation. He saw the point that I was making. And he said, Mr. Gandhi, let me see what I can do. He said, I need to send you the information. 20 days later, along with the information, they sent it to me that Police Inspector Prakash Amri had been dismissed from service. That is the power of right to information that any one citizen sitting at home can exercise. You can do it. A little girl of 10 sitting in even a hut can actually achieve this. This is possible. Was it solely because of the RTI? The answer is no. RTI was a catalyst. But the catalyst is required for something to happen, for something to translate, and good government officers must get support from us. Do all RTI applications work? My answer is no. There is a lot of culture of opacity, not following the law, etc., which is standard in India. Therefore, I'm not saying all work. Some work, some don't. Sometimes you'll get information, sometimes you may not get information. They will defend the case very much, even if you go for appeals and so on. But my analysis shows that about 30% of the times, some small change occurs in the governance. Even at times when they may not give you the information, but they realize we can't repeat this kind of error because next time around we'll get caught. So 30% of the times, some small change occurs in the governance of the country. Here's a dream I want to share with you. If 30 lakh Indian citizens, 30 lakh is not a big figure for a 130 crore population. If 30 lakh Indian citizens take a vow once a month to file one RTI application about a matter that they are concerned with, about a matter that they are cribbing with, and you don't need to find extra time, out of the 3 or 4 hours of cribbing that you do, reduce half an hour. Half an hour is all that it takes you to file an RTI application. So, 3.5 ghanta aloshna karte rahiye, kul karte rahiye, half an hour, file one RTI application on a subject that is important to you. You don't have to get together, you don't have to form an association, you don't even have to agree with your friend, teacher, colleague, husband or wife. You file it independently. And don't worry about what happens. If you feel like if they don't give you, file an appeal. But even if you don't do that, just the act that you file will change things. If 30 lakh Indian citizens take this vow, 3.5 crore RTI applications will be filed in a year. 1 crore times. 30% of that. If you make a small change in the governance of India, in 5 years, India would be a different nation. Our democracy would be a far more vibrant, accountable democracy. And you can do it individually. You don't have to worry whether your friend does it or not. We have talk of karmanyam adhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana. I was talking like this at one forum. One old person, older than me, got up and said, Mr. Gandhi, ye sab baate to achhi lagti hai sunne ko. Maine 10 saal RTI kiya. कुछ नहीं हुआ इंडिया में कुछ हो ही नहीं सकता है काही शक्य नाही इंडिया मध्ये आपल्या देशात असंच चालणार काही फरक नाही पडणार टू हिम एंड टू फ्रेंड्स लाइक हिम आई से अ लॉट ऑफ अस गो टू मंदिर्स मस्जिद्स गुरुद्वारास चर्चेस अग्यारीस वंस अ डे वंस अ वीक वंस अ मंथ मे बी वंस अ ईयर व्हेन यू गो देयर एंड कम आउट Do you have an extra 100 rupee note in your wallet? No. Why do you do it? You do it as an act of faith. We have faith that by doing this, something good will happen to me, my family, my friends, my city, my nation, whatever. What do we do for the nation as an act of faith? Zero. Shall we try it as an act of faith for the nation? When we go to a mandir, masjid, etc., we see no logical connection. How it will improve or change anything. It's an act of faith. Fair enough. That's good. Here you can see a logical possibility that you can at least logically think that possibility is that something will happen. impact the governance of the country. 30 lakh Indian citizens, if they do this, because they are the Badshahs and Begums of this nation, we can change the face of India. We can change our democracy. And if we change our democracy, our prosperity, our fairness, our rule of law will get established. If you don't do that, then only you can do it. Nobody else will do it. No Prime Minister, no President can make it happen. No Chief Justice can make it happen. Only the citizens of India acting individually will make it happen. Think about it and please. Okay, summary for Bharat Sustain. Applications can also be made online at rtionline.maharashtra.gov.in. Online RTI application will be paid. Fees can be paid by credit card. Summary for central government also, RTI application can be filed online. Here's a slightly different topic, but a topic that I would like to excite you with. RTI ke saath mein concern for the nation. Why does my government not work? We basically blame political class, we blame the bureaucrats, we blame everybody except us. I would also urge you, with half an hour of RTI, take up one more half an hour session on figuring out why my government doesn't work. What is wrong with the way my government is working? This is one of the topics. I deal with five or six topics, but if each one of you takes up such a topic of analyzing and saying, what is the solution? Why does my government not work? Judicial backlogs, we are all aware of. Tariq pe tariq. Woh famous ho gaya, actor. But no change in anything. Judicial backlogs can become histories by submission. Usual solutions suggested. Major judicial reforms. Judges must perform better. No adjournments. Change laws. Double or triple the number of judges. Justice Thakur, standing with Mr. Modi on his platform, said, he had tears running down his eyes. And he said, I need 70,000 judges. Kya karu main? At that time, the number of sanctioned judges was about 24,000 or 26,000. Except that the problem cannot be solved and it will keep growing bigger. Justice V.V. Rao of Andhra Pradesh court said we need 320 years to clear the backlog. Without changing anything in the way the courts work, how many judges will be required to clear the incoming cases? I've done an analysis taking 12 years data from the Supreme Court website. And this analysis is based on a simple assumption that if 10 judges dispose 10,000 cases in a year, 12 judges will clear 20,000. On a national average, I understand cases are different. So it's not talking of each one, but on a national average, it's a reasonable assumption. It may be off by 5-10%, but that's about the all. And I did this arithmetic taking information from the website of the Supreme Court. Justice Thakur said, I need 70,000 judges. Now, I studied the number of sanctioned judges and the vacancy in the sanctioned positions each year for these 12 years. The average was 12% average vacancy for Supreme Court, 32% for the High Courts, and 20% for the subordinate judiciary. Do I need to keep this vacancy? Is a question we should ask. India suffers rule of law, India suffers badly, and the poor suffer more than everybody else. Equality before law is a fiction. Right to speedy justice is a fundamental right which is broken every day in my courts, day in and day out. But can we decide that we want to find a solution? And if the vacancies have not been kept, what would have been the impact? In 12 years' time, total number of cases instituted in Supreme Court was 8.9 lakh cases, High Courts was 215.58 lakhs, Lower Courts was 2156.38 lakhs, total number of cases were 2380.86 lakhs in 23 crore cases. Average per year was 198.4 lakh cases. Cases disposed is also surprisingly not all that behind. The total average cases per year is 193.7 lakhs. So the increase in the pendency is just 4.7 lakh cases a year. 2.5%. That's all there is the increase in cases. And our average sanctioned positions are not filled by 21%. If those judges had been filled, this is what I call missed disposals. 55.1 lakh cases would have been cleared each year. Don't take it as a particular perfection. Within 5-10%, it would still be valid. balance spending at the end of the 12-year period was this. Balance spending could have been, going arithmetically, minus 3 crore 12 lakh cases. We could have imported cases from Pakistan, Kenya, Bangladesh, everywhere. Which means our sanctioned positions are adequate. I'm not saying this is to arithmetical perfection. Maybe 5%, 10% is the rule, even 5% vacancies are there. Even then, if we make it a policy to ensure that all judicial positions are filled up, which is not happening. If we fill those up and deal with this, deal with other issues like this, come up with solutions. Every solution may not work, but some of these solutions could work. Governance of India is your job and my job. You are the Badshahs and Begums, and you will look at this, I am hoping, carefully. Mera Bharat Mahan, we talk about it, we say it. We ride behind tempos, trucks, taxis. Mera Bharat Mahan. Nowadays there is a great talk of nationalism, patriotism. झंडे के नीचे खड़े रहेंगे तो पेट्रियॉट हो गए हम देश प्रेमी बन गए. दीज आर यूजफुल सिंबल्स. सिंगिंग जन गण मन, स्टैंडिंग बिफोर द नेशनल फ्लैग, सिंग भारत माता की जय, यूजफुल. बट ओनली एज सिंबल्स, दे विल नॉट चेंज एनीथिंग. इफ द नेशन डिसाइडेड फॉर अ फुल डे दैट वी विल नॉट ईट ड्रिंक एनीथिंग फ्रॉम मॉर्निंग 8 टू इवनिंग 8 एंड स्टैंड बिलो फ्लैग्स एंड सिंग जन गण मन, नथिंग विल चेंज. These are symbols and they must be recognized as symbols. So, patriotism is to be something deeper. It must run under your bloodstream. Say, I want to make India better and I can. I individually, not hum. I individually will make India better. Have that faith. And believe me, you will be able to contribute. And therefore, I say, at this stage, Mera Bharat Mahan nahi hai. मेरा भारत महान नहीं है पर ये दोष मेरा है. आई द इंडिविजुअल सॉवरेन सिटीजन ऑफ दिस नेशन एम रिस्पॉन्सिबल. मैं इस देश का बादशाह हूं और मेरी जिम्मेदारी है अगर ये देश महान नहीं है. एंड ईच वन ऑफ यू टू टेक दिस मैसेज. राइट टू इन्फॉर्मेशन करेंगे तो बहुत अच्छा है, समझेंगे तो बहुत अच्छा है. बट वो नहीं भी किया, गो अराउंड व्हेन यू लुक एट एनीथिंग. मैं इस देश का बादशाह हूं, मैं इस देश की बेगम हूं, अगर ठीक नहीं है तो मुझे ठीक करना है. यू विल ब्रिंग अ चेंज. And you can bring a change, and only you can bring the change. Thank you, friends. Now, if you have questions, I'd be delighted to answer them.
When we file right to information application, do we get any receipt or acknowledgement?
Yeah. Okay. One, depending on how you do it. A, if you give it by hand, then take a photocopy and get a chapa on the copy. Alternately, what I do is I don't go to any place. I send everything by speed post and take a speed post tracking report and keep it with myself. So go to the internet, take a speed post tracking report. Third possibility is if you're filing it online, take a screenshot of the RTI application and keep it, and that's your adequate.
Because generally the tendency is not to give acknowledgement receipt from the government authority.
Okay, if you find such a problem, send it by speed post. As I said, I always send everything by speed post because there are some problems in when you go physically, somebody says asai, tasai, tasai. Forget all that. Just send it by speed post. Cost you about 20 rupees or so.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, a case after recently my sobat jalti ki एक वस्तुमापन विभाग होता, त्याच्यातनं म्हणजे आमच्या स्वतःच्या दुकानावरती होलसेलरवरती एक फाईन झाला होता 5,000 rupees. सो त्या केसमध्ये वैद्यमापन अंडर एक हे लावलं होतं की मॅन्युफॅक्चरर, सप्लायर आणि होलसेलर ह्या तीन गोष्टी होत्या. तर तिघांनासुद्धा फाईन मारलं असं अधिकाऱ्याचं म्हणणं होतं, पण आम्हाला फक्त आमच्या फाईनची रिसीट आम्हाला भेटली. पण जो मॅन्युफॅक्चरर आहे आणि जो सप्लायर आहे त्याची रिसीट मी त्या अधिकाऱ्याकडे मागितली की आम्हाला जे त्यांना रिसीट मागितली, कारण केस फाईल केली आमच्या IPC 174 अंडर. सो ती रिसीट मागितली. सो त्या अधिकाऱ्याने सांगितलं की हे RTI अंडर येत नाही, की आम्ही कोणाची पर्सनल रिसीट तुम्हाला देऊ म्हणून.
बकवास करताय. दिस इज अ पब्लिक रेकॉर्ड. only if it is denial, if it is breach of privacy, or it is not a public activity. This is a public activity. And tell her, hey, Sangha, if you are going to the appeal forum, ask that please make a statement that you will not give this information to parliament or state legislature. तुम्ही महाराष्ट्राचे विधानसभेला हे इन्फॉर्मेशन देणार नाही असं स्टेटमेंट करा, देन यू कॅन क्लेम अंडर 81J. यू मे मेक अ राईट ऑर रॉंग, पण तुम्ही स्टेटमेंट तरी करा. अँड इफ यू कांट मेक दॅट स्टेटमेंट, यू हॅव टू गिव्ह मी द इन्फॉर्मेशन.
हॅलो सर. Sir, recently there was an amendment in the RTI Act regarding the salaries and all. So, can you just brief on...
Sure. Yeah. You see, the first draft of the bill was presented to Parliament on December 21st, 2004. In that draft, the then government had proposed that the Central Information Commissioner's positions would be equal to that of Joint Secretaries in the Government of India. And State Information Commission is slightly lower than that. Parliament demanded a Parliamentary Standing Committee to discuss this bill. In that Parliamentary Standing Committee, there were about 27 members, 8 of whom were BJP members, members of the current ruling party, including the current President of India. He was also a member on that. So for 2 months they deliberated and then came up with a suggestion. They said that this Information Commissioners to be independent and to give fearless decisions when involved with government issues should be placed on a fairly high pedestal. They must have a higher rank and their tenure should be fixed. So they proposed that the tenure should be 5 years and the Central Information Commissioner should be equal to the Election Commissioners. The Election Commissioners are equal to a Supreme Court judge. So when I was an Information Commissioner, my position was equal to that of a Supreme Court judge. This was accepted by the government and incorporated in the final bill. Now, the statement of object states that information commissions are statutory bodies and the election commission is a constitutional body. Therefore, they cannot be equated, which is absurd. Against the information commission's decisions, High Court is approached in writ jurisdiction. That was the argument given by DOPT minister in the house. He said their decisions are challenged in High Court, so how can they be higher than High Court? That was the implication. Even the president's order and governor's orders are challenged before the High Courts under writ jurisdiction. So I don't know whether the government meant that they want to bring down the governor's and the president's position to below High Court level. The government is not telling the truth. But it is more a question of ego, of trying to control. So they have said, we'll decide on the tenure, we'll frame rules for the tenure and the salaries. And now I think they are making them equal to joint secretary. What these party had said should not be done is being done now. It is more an issue of personal arrogance. And also, my suspicion is, this is something nothing to do with law. My suspicion is politically, see, if you think carefully, this was the first bill amendment that they brought to which there was some opposition. Now, they were not sure of the Rajya Sabha numbers. In Rajya Sabha, they were not sure. They wanted to bring Triple Talaq and Citizenship Amendment Act. But before they went, last year they had got defeat in the Rajya Sabha on some bills. They didn't want a defeat on those bills again. So my own theory is that they probably set it as a trial balloon. Isko support mil jata hai kya? Isko support mil gaya to fir abhi hum baaki ke bills kar sakte hai. I do not think they had, and in all fairness, I must concede one thing. Whereas it does theoretically put them in a situation of control, it is not damaging the art. They have not taken away the powers of the commission. They have not changed any of the exemptions. So those things have not been done. So significantly, it doesn't affect that. But we need better commissioners. Commissioners who will kowtow to the word of the government are bad. But we have a host of such commissions, unfortunately.
Hello. गुड मॉर्निंग सर. मला काय गोष्ट विचारायचं होता की ना आत्ता सध्या महाराष्ट्रामध्ये ना महाराष्ट्र किंवा देशाच्या लेवलला आरटीआय कार्यकर्त्यांची मोठ्या प्रमाणात हत्या होती, तर याच्यासाठी बाबा स्पेसिफिक प्रोव्हिजन काय किंवा त्यांना प्रोटेक्शन देण्यासाठी आपण काय करू शकतो?
इस सवाल का जवाब मैं ऐसे दूंगा कि फर्स्ट थिंग इज इट इज नॉट आरटीआई अलोन. जो भी सिस्टम को चैलेंज करता है, स्थापित हितों को चैलेंज करता है, उसको कुछ रिस्क रहता है, बहुत छोटा, बहुत बड़ा नहीं रहता है. इसको प्रोटेक्शन के लिए सचमुच गवर्नेंस इटसेल्फ बेटर होना चाहिए. ऐसा सोचना कि आरटीआई वालों को प्रोटेक्शन मिल जाएगा, दूसरों को नहीं मिलेगा, ये तो हो नहीं सकता है. आरटीआई वाले जो हम कहते हैं, आज जो भी स्थापित हितों के सामने काम कर रहा है वो आरटीआई का इस्तेमाल कर रहा है. अगर कोई बोलेगा कि एक आदमी को किसी ने मार डाला क्योंकि इसकी दुश्मनी थी तो कोई कहीं अटेंशन नहीं देता है, पर आरटीआई यूज़ है तो सबने किया होता है. तो ये कहा तो आरटीआई की वजह से ही मौत होती है, ऐसी बात नहीं है. सवाल यह है कि हम देश में कायदा की व्यवस्था ठीक कर सकते हैं या नहीं. आज अपने देश में गुनाह करने वालों को पकड़ना बहुत रेयर है, पहले तो पुलिस ही नहीं कंप्लेन लेती है. आपको मालूम है और ये आंकड़ा समझने लायक है, कॉग्निजेबल क्राइम्स इन यूनाइटेड स्टेट्स पर 1000 पॉपुलेशन इज अबाउट 40 पर ईयर. स्वीडन में 30 है, यूके में 100 है, इंडिया में कितना होगा आंकड़ा आप क्या समझते हैं? गेस करिए, गेस करो, गेस करो. हाँ, दो टू कॉग्निजेबल क्राइम्स पर 1000 पॉपुलेशन. आई जस्ट गिव यू अ सिंपल स्टेटिस्टिक. कैलकटा इन 1907 रजिस्टर्ड 47,000 to 48,000 कॉग्निजेबल क्राइम्स, 1907. मुंबई फ्रॉम 1984 टू 2016-17 हैज रिकॉर्डेड क्राइम्स ओनली इन द रीजन ऑफ 30,000 to 40,000. जास्त नाही, कमी नाही. द ट्रूथ इज वी डू नॉट रिकॉर्ड आवर क्राइम्स. सो माय पॉइंट इज वी नीड टू एस्टैब्लिश अ सिस्टम ऑफ व्हाट वी कॉल अ रियल रूल ऑफ लॉ. आज रूल ऑफ लॉ टू सम एक्सटेंट एग्जिस्ट ओनली फॉर द बेटर ऑफ क्लासेस. और अ पुअर मैन इफ ही इज मैड इनफ टू परस्यू हिज स्पेंड हिज होल लाइफ मे बी ही विल गेट सम जस्टिस. वी नीड टू चेंज दैट. एंड रिस्क वाइज I tell each one, first, I don't believe the risk is very high. I've never received a threat. I've done a lot of big exposes. B, if you feel that you are threatened, decide on your own safety level. Decide not to file something where you feel your physical safety will be at risk. Other techniques are getting 10 people to file an RTI application or getting a person from a different city to file the RTI application. But do not feel worried. आणि एकच सांगतोय, आत्तापर्यंत अंदाजाने 90 लोक 14 वर्षात त्यांची मृत्यू झाली आहे आरटीआयचे ॲप्लिकेशनमुळे असं आम्हाला वाटतंय. मुंबईचे रस्त्यावर रोज 10 लोकांची मृत्यू होते ॲक्सिडेंटमध्ये, म्हणजे आपण चालायचा बंद नाही करत. बट अगेन अनदर टिप इज डू नॉट एव्हर यूज इट आउट ऑफ रिवेंज ऑफ वेंजन्स. मी काही लोकांना बघितलं आहे ते आरटीआय वापरलं की त्यांनाही ॲरोगन्स येते, अरे मी दाखवून देणार तुला असं नका सांगू कोणाला. अँड दॅट शुड नेवर बी दी इंटेन्शन. इंटेन्शन शुड बी की मी सिस्टम बरोबर करणार, मला काही रॉंग झालं आहे ते राईट करणार, बट कुणाला दाखवून देणार. आणि ते पण मी आरटीआय वाढायला बघितलं आहे, आपल्या समाजात काम करणारे जे थोडं म्हणजे प्रसिद्धी भेटते की अरे मी पण राजा, ते घमंड शिवाय जर आरटीआय केली तर माझा हिशोबाने फार कमी चान्सेस आहे सिक्युरिटी रिस्कचे.
सर काय आता सध्या ना काय माहिती का जे पॉलिटिक्स किंवा नाही का पॉलिटिक्स थ्रू गव्हर्नमेंटचे टेंडर निघले जातात, तर टेंडरला समजा टेंडरचं जर काम पूर्ण चालू झालं तर काय जी गाव लेवलला किंवा पॉलिटिक्स रिलेटेड जे लोक आहेत त्याचे नवीन परमिशन काढतात, तर त्याच्यातून जास्त प्रमाणात हल्ले वगैरे होण्याचे चान्सेस जास्त आहे किंवा होतात पण. आता मी रिसेंट एक केस पाहिली की ना आरटीआय थ्रू त्यांनी टेंडर होतं पालिकेचं गव्हर्नमेंटचं त्यांनी घेतलं, पण नंतर काय झालं की ना समोरच्या अपोजिट पार्टीवाल्यांनी त्यांची नवीन परमिशन मागितल्यानंतर त्यांच्यावरती त्यांनी जीवघेयांना हल्ला केला आणि त्याच्यात ते मृत्युमुखी पडले. तर सर ह्या लोकांना ना लवकर न्याय पण मिळत नाही,
आता एक दुसरा एक सांगतोय, बरेचसे आर टी आय वापरणारे अशी इन्फॉर्मेशन स्वतःचा कडेच ठेवतात, ते नका करू, पब्लिश करून टाका. इन्फॉर्मेशन आली लगेच सर्वांशी शेअर करा. आणि दुसरं मी सांगितलं तसं, 10 लोक 12 लोकांनी केलं, दुसऱ्या शहरात कुणी केलं जिथे तुम्हाला असं वाटत असेल, तर हे फार उपयोगी होऊ शकते.
थँक्यू सर. हॅलो सर, थँक्यू फॉर युअर व्हॅल्युएबल नॉलेज. सर, ॲज यू हॅव फाईल्ड वेरियस ॲप्लिकेशन बिफोर वेरियस ऑथॉरिटीज, पब्लिक ऑथॉरिटीज आय मीन, सर, कॅन यू शेअर सम इन्स्टन्सेस वेअर यू हॅव फेस प्रॅक्टिकल डिफिकल्टीज वाईल इम्प्लिमेंटिंग प्रोव्हिजन्स अंडर आर टी आय?
सी, वन प्रॉब्लम इज दॅट अ लॉट ऑफ रेकॉर्ड्स आर नॉट ट्रेसेबल द वे द गव्हर्नमेंट वर्क्स ऑर डझंट वर्क. The record keeping is extremely poor. That is one practical problem. The other is this tendency of opacity. And unfortunately, the courts in India are not very RTI friendly. Before the RTI Act came, they have made outstanding judgments on RTI and transparency. You know, it makes me stand up and want to salute. After the RTI Act, they realized it applies to them also. So the tone has changed clearly. But at the same time, the beauty of RTI is that individually we can do it. We don't have to create a mass movement. We don't have to get 1 lakh people together. We don't have to get even 1,000 people together. Apna ghari basun apna RTI karu shakta. That is its biggest. And today also the RTI movement, All India, has no national leader. Asa nahi ki he mandar basa asa karayacha kahiz nahi. मुंबईमध्ये मी बोलणार अर्धे लोक ऐकणार नाही मला. बट दॅट इज इट स्ट्रेंथ. इट इज रिअली इंडिव्हिज्युअल बेस्ड, इंडिव्हिज्युअल सिटिझन बेस्ड, इंडिव्हिज्युअल एम्पॉवरमेंट. अँड यू जस्ट हॅव टू हॅव दॅट फेथ दॅट आम्ही केलं. यू वी नॉट सी रिझल्ट डायरेक्टली, बट द फॅक्ट दॅट आय फाईल आर टी ॲप्लिकेशन, दॅट अ फॅक्ट दॅट आय थिंक अबाउट माय नेशन, द फॅक्ट दॅट आय थिंक अबाउट माय गव्हर्नन्स, इफ इनफ ऑफ अस डू इट अक्रॉस द कंट्री, वी विल विन. वी कॅनॉट लूज दिस.
सर, US मध्ये क्लासिफाईड इन्फॉर्मेशन 30 वर्षानंतर पब्लिक केली जाते, तसे काही प्रोव्हिजन आपल्याकडे आहे का?
आपल्याकडे क्लासिफाईड पब्लिक करायचं नाही, परंतु आरटी ऍक्ट मध्ये हे सांगितलं आहे की 20 वर्षानंतर 10 exemption क्लॉजेस आहे, त्यातले 3च राहणार, 7 निघून जाणार. ते अमिताभ बच्चनचा असते ना 50-50, इथे 70-30 केला आहे. 70% ऑफ द एक्झम्प्शन विल नॉट अप्लाय आफ्टर 20 इयर्स. सो वी हॅव दॅट प्रोव्हिजन. वी डोंट हॅव एक्झॅक्टली अ डीक्लासिफिकेशन प्रोव्हिजन.
जस्ट वन सेकंड. थँक यू व्हेरी मच.
अँड आय अगेन वॉन्ट ऑल द बादशाहज एंड बेगम्स टू रेज देअर हँड्स. Thank you. Thank you very much.